Hi students, let's continue our discussion of the electrostatics and fast track revision series for JEE Main. In the last video, we have discussed about the electric lines of forces, equipotential surface and electric flux. Now continuing our discussion, we are going to have a discussion about the Gauss law in this particular part. Gauss law is a very important topic of electrostatics. And it is very much required to understand the behavior of conductors in electrostatics in detail. Now, first I am explaining you the Gauss law. According to Gauss law, for any closed surface, if I consider a closed surface means any three-dimensional surface like sphere, cube, cuboid, cylinder, etc. Any three-dimensional closed surface. That much be closed from all the sides. It must not be open from any side. That is the meaning of the word closed. Any closed surface, if any closed surface is there, then flux linked with, electric flux linked with this closed surface is equal to the net charges enclosed by the surface divided by epsilon naught. This is the expression flux linked with. This is the flux linked with a small part. This circle is here representing closed integral. Means this integral has been performed over a closed surface. Closed surface enclosing some volume. This is the net electric flux linked with a closed surface is equal to the charge enclosed. Q enclosed is charge enclosed. What is the net charge enclosed by that object? By surface divided by epsilon naught. Here I want to say here, this Q enclosed is net charge enclosed by the surface. Let's try to understand it with the help of an example. Let us consider this Gaussian surface, this Gaussian surface. Now, here we have few charges, Q1 outside the surface, minus Q2 outside the surface, Q3 minus Q4, Q5 minus Q6. So here we have taken only 6 charges. It is not necessary only 6 charges, infinite charges are possible. Some are inside and some are outside. These 3 charges are 0. Now these all charges in the space will produce any electric field at different points on this Gaussian, on this surface. Will produce some electric field at different points on the surface. Let us say I have considered this small element of the surface here, which has been shown in yellow in color. Here at this particular location, E is the electric field. What is E? E is the electric field intensity at considered location due to all the charges present in space. This is the electric field intensity at this point. Electric field intensity due to all these charges is E vector. And here we have ds vector. This ds vector is the area vector for this surface. Ds vector is the area vector for this surface. Then the flux linked with this surface, this particular small element, is dot product of E and ds. E dot ds. Now this E is different at different points. Angle between the E and ds is different at different points. So to compute the total flux linked with this surface, we have to go for the integral. Now this, if I take this particular example only and I write E dot ds is equal to total charge enclosed. Now if you see here, the total charge enclosed is Q3 minus Q4 plus Q5 upon epsilon naught. This becomes the total flux linked with this closed surface. Right? This surface. Now, right side you see. Right side we have to consider only those charges which are inside the surface. Inside the closed surface. Only those charges has to be considered. It is a very, very important thing. Now, some important factual points about this I am telling you. You can see. Surface over which we apply the Gauss law is termed as the Gaussian surface. Like in this particular previous case, if I say we are applying the Gauss law over this surface, then it is termed as, this surface will be termed as the Gaussian surface. Now you have to remember that at the Gaussian surface, or Gaussian surface has not to pass through any discrete point charge. It can pass through the continuous charge. Gaussian surface can pass through the continuous charge, but cannot pass through the discrete point charges. I'll explain you the reason also. Let us consider we have a uniformly charged solid sphere. Solid sphere. And we have one Gaussian surface, say like this type of, this is the Gaussian surface. This green colored surface is the Gaussian surface. Now, this green colored surface is passing through, some points are there where charge is located. This all points, charge is located. Now, but electric field intensity is defined at all the points. So there is no trouble at all. It can pass through the continuous charge. But now let us consider another situation. You have one Gaussian surface and here some point charges are there. Say one point charge here, Q1, one point charge Q2, one point charge Q3, point charge Q4, Q5, etc. Now, to compute the flux, we have to write E dot ds. E is at different points on the surface. Now, we need the value of E to be written at the location of Q2 also. But at the location of the charge, E is not defined. And when E is not defined at this point, then how we will write the flux? So for this particular closed surface, we cannot write the flux. That's why Gaussian surface has not to pass through the discrete point charges. It is a very, very important statement. Gaussian surface may pass through the continuous charge distribution, but it cannot pass through the discrete point charges, right? Now, let's take another statement. The flux linked with the Gaussian surface is independent of shape and size of Gaussian surface. Try to understand. Let us consider one Gaussian surface, this one. When you consider, say, like this one. When you consider, say, this one. Now let us consider we have placed one charge Q here. Same charge inside this, same charge inside this, and one more Gaussian surface you consider, say it is of cuboid type. Like this. And same charge Q is placed inside here also. Now, if somebody asks what is the flux linked with this Gaussian surface, then it is very easy. We have seen the Gauss law. The flux linked with a closed surface is equal to Q by epsilon naught. What is the net charge enclosed? Q. So the flux linked is Q by epsilon naught. Now, with this cylindrical surface, what is the flux linked? Again, you will say only the charge enclosed is Q, so Q by epsilon. Flux linked with this surface. Now, here if you see, this is a sphere, but whose size is smaller than this? So, here also you will say flux linked with P, Q upon epsilon naught also. Here also you will say the flux linked is Q by epsilon naught. So, flux linked with a Gaussian surface is same for different shapes, is same for different sizes, provided the charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface is same. So it is depending only of the charge enclosed by the surface. It is not depending upon the what is the shape, what is the size, and third thing is what is the location of the charge inside the Gaussian surface. See this point also, location 1. Let us consider one Gaussian surface, this one. Now, one point charge is closed here, placed here. Q, what is the charge linked with, flux linked with this Gaussian surface? You can say directly Q by epsilon naught. Now, let us say I brought this Q from here to here, near to the surface. What is the flux linked? Again, you will say Q by epsilon naught. If I will bring this from here to here, then also the flux linked is Q by epsilon naught. So, the flux linked with a closed surface is independent of the location of charge inside the surface. It's independent of the shape and size of the Gaussian surface. It depends only on the total net charge enclosed by the surface. Right? I hope these two points are clear. Now, take the third point. It is also a very nice, interesting point. Now, already I have told you, if we are considering the any closed surface, Gaussian surface, this is our Gaussian surface. It is our Gaussian surface. And we have some charges here, Q1, Q2, say Q3 here. Then, in the Gaussian surface, E dot ds, in the left hand side, this E is due to all the charges present in the space. It is due to all the charges present in the space. When you are finding the flux here, you are going to consider one small element, then write down the electric field. Then this electric field is not due to the inner charges. It is due to all the charges present in the space. So in the LHS of the Gauss law, E is due to all the charges present in the space. But in the right hand side of the Gauss law, we have to consider only those charges which are inside the surface. Means when we are writing the right hand side of the Gauss law, we have to write only Q1, Q3. Sorry, let us take this as Q2 because outside also Q3 written. So Q1, Q2 only inside. In the LHS of the Gauss law, E is due to all the charges present in the space, while in the RHS of the Gauss law, you have to consider only the charges enclosed by the surface. A very nice point you have to remember. Many questions you can find on the basis of this point, conceptual also and numericals also. Next point you take. Now, this is also a very nice thing. You see here, first I am explaining you, consider this as the Gaussian surface and you have one point charge placed at the center of this spherical Gaussian surface. Spherical Gaussian surface, at the center one charge is placed. Now this radius you take as R. So what is the electric field at all the points on the magnitude of the electric field at all the points on the this spherical Gaussian surface, it will be equal to Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught r square, right? Small r square. And direction will be this way, right? Now you see, if you change the position of this charged particle from here to here, say you brought this particle from here to here, then at all the points, electric field will change. Then at all the points, electric field will change. But what is the flux linked with the surface when the charge is here? Q by epsilon naught. What is the flux linked with this surface when the charge is here? Same Q by epsilon naught. Means in this particular expression, E is changing everywhere if we are changing the position of the charge. But this entire thing is not changing. A very highly remarkable property of the Gauss law on moving the charge inside or outside without crossing the boundary. Like say for example, you have some charges outside also, some charges inside also. You move this charge, you move this charge. In both the cases, E will change here. See the lead on the screen. E will change here, whether you displace the inner charges or outside charges. But the total flux won't change, provided inner charge is not crossing the boundary as well as outer charges are not crossing the boundary. Right? Because of the movement of the charges, electric field at all the points in the Gaussian surface changing, but the total flux linked with the Gaussian surface does not changing. Reason is, at some portion, the flux linked with the Gaussian surface is increasing. At some other portion, the flux linked with the Gaussian surface is decreasing. I will say it is one of the most important point, most conceptual, most remarkable point in this particular part. You have to remember it. Right? Take the next point. Yes, this is also very helpful in solving few questions. If we have any symmetrical surface, Gaussian surface, say for example, cube, sphere, right? So if a point charge is placed at the center of the Gaussian surface, which is having n identical faces, I'll explain it in other way. If Gaussian surface is having symmetrical configuration and it is having symmetrically n faces, and a point charge is located at geometrical center. Point charge is located at geometrical center. Then flux linked with each face, flux linked with each face is equal to Q by epsilon naught into 1 by n. Total flux is Q by epsilon naught. And the flux linked with each face, because charge is located symmetrically, becomes 1 by n times. Now, another situation. If charge is not placed symmetrically, if charge is not placed symmetrically, then total flux will be same, Q by epsilon naught. But the flux linked with different faces will be different. A situation has been shown in the diagram here. Both are the Q. In the case A, a point charge Q is at the geometrical center. While in the case B, point charge is not at the center but near to one vertex, but inside only. Now, what is the charge enclosed by this Gaussian surface? In case A, this Gaussian surface, Q. So the total flux linked with this Gaussian surface is Q by epsilon naught. What is the total flux linked with this Gaussian surface? B case. Charge enclosed, Q. So what is the total flux linked with this? Q by epsilon naught. This charge is also Q only. Now here, charge is placed symmetrically. That's why the flux linked with this face or this face or this face or this face or this face equal to, because here 6 symmetrical faces, so 1 by 6 q by epsilon naught. But here the flux linked with this surface, you cannot say q by 6 epsilon naught, or with this q by 6 epsilon naught, because the total flux is not divided equally here, right? Now, next point you can take. If the flux linked with a Gaussian surface, say we have one Gaussian surface, and total flux linked with this Gaussian surface is zero, total flux, then what you can say, this total flux is equal to E dot ds is equal to Q by epsilon naught, Q enclosed by epsilon naught. Then this doesn't mean E is zero at every point. Yes, this means that net charge enclosed is zero. Net charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface is zero. This is right. But E is zero at all the points? Not correct. Because it might be possible for some region of the Gaussian surface, this flux is coming positive, and for some other region, the flux is coming negative. So flux linked with a Gaussian surface zero doesn't mean E is zero at all the points. Take one more point. Gaussian surface may be an imaginary surface. Means what actually I want to say, it is not necessary that at the location of Gaussian surface some material must exist. Like for example, if I am having a solid conductor, this is, I am writing it as solid conductor. So here everywhere we have the material. Everywhere material is there. Now, if I take the Gaussian surface here, here the material is present. Material is present. So it doesn't mean wherever Gaussian surface will be there, material must be present. We can have the Gaussian surface here also. We can have the Gaussian surface like this also. Now, here no material is present. So Gaussian surface may be located at that in such a way also that it is not passing through any material point. It is in vacuum, it is in air. So all those things are there. So this is all about the Gauss law. You have to remember in the Gauss law that flux linked with a closed surface, this closed surface is the surface which encloses. Let's discuss the next application of the Gauss law. In this application, we can determine the electric field by using the Gauss law. What is the benefit of this method? In general, whenever we have to find the electric field due to some extended object, we have to go for the integration technique, which is a very lengthy and cumbersome process. But we can make use of the Gauss law to determine the electric field due to some either the infinite charge distribution or some symmetrical charge distribution. Then this particular method, the Gauss law, is going to save a lot of time. So we are discussing this particular aspect. Now here I'm explaining you the step-by-step procedure. And along with that, we'll discuss that if we have to find the electric field due to any such object, extended object, then by using the Gauss law, how to proceed. Now, let us say I'm taking an example. We have to find the electric field intensity. Find electric field intensity due to infinite long uniformly charged wire. And where we want to find this electric field? Say at this point P we are interested, right? Now one is by using the integration that we already have seen the expression, but now we are using the Gauss law. Now if you want to determine this, first of all you have to choose a Gaussian surface. So first thing is you have to choose the Gaussian surface. Here in the left side you see, choose a Gaussian surface. Now what is the point you have to keep in mind while choosing the Gaussian surface? So while choosing the Gaussian surface, only one point you keep in mind, that you should choose the Gaussian surface in such a way that calculation of E dot ds over that surface becomes easy. While choosing Gaussian surface, we should keep in mind that calculation of E dot ds over the surface becomes simple. This is the first thing you have to remember. And to make this simple, if your Gaussian surface is an equipotential surface, then it is very nice. Then the calculation of the flux linked over the surface will become very easy. Now you see, this is the infinite line charge. This is the infinite line charge. And due to this infinite line charge, at this point P, at a distance R, this distance is R. Right, the distance of point P from this infinite long wire is R. At this point, we have to find the field. So what we are doing, we are considering this Gaussian surface, cylindrical Gaussian surface. Our Gaussian surface is cylindrical Gaussian surface. Now, over this cylindrical Gaussian surface, if we see from the symmetry of the charged object, electric field intensity at all the points on the curved surface of this will be E. Electric field intensity at all the points on this curved surface, only curved surface, this part will be E, same. And this E and area vector are parallel. Electric field and area vector are becoming parallel. And if we see over this planar surfaces, electric field is in this direction and area vector this way. Electric field here, area vector here. These two are perpendicular. So the flux linked in this part and this part will become zero. So total flux, choose a Gaussian surface over. We have to find the flux now. Now the total flux is equal to E into 2 pi R L plus flux linked with upper plane surface 0 plus flux linked with lower surface 0. This is the total flux linked. Right? Now the next step is we have to find the charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface. This is the Gaussian surface. This is the Gaussian surface, this one. So what is the charge enclosed? Only this part of the wire is inside the Gaussian surface. Now charge density of the wire is lambda and only L length of the wire is inside the Gaussian surface. So what is the total charge enclosed? Charge enclosed comes out to be lambda into L. Now, next step is we have to apply the Gauss law. Gauss law is saying the flux is equal to charge enclosed by epsilon naught. So, flux is E into 2 pi RL is equal to charge enclosed, Q enclosed upon epsilon naught. So, this is going to give us E is equal to lambda upon 2 pi epsilon naught r, which is a result which we already know also. But you see how easily we can find it by using the Gauss law. So I am summarizing the steps. First, you choose a Gaussian surface, then you find the flux linked with the Gaussian surface, then find the charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface, then use the Gauss law. Only thing what you have to keep in your mind is, while choosing the Gaussian surface, choose it in such a way that calculation of E dot ds becomes simple. Calculation of E dot ds will become simple in most of the cases if the Gaussian surface is an equipotential surface, because in equipotential surface, electric field and area vector are parallel. You don't have to do anything. Directly you can multiply. No integration will be needed. For this, I am taking one more situation. You see, let us consider one spherical charge distribution where the charge density is not constant, but rather it is rho is given as rho naught into 1 minus r by r, means as a function of distance r, volume charge density is this. And we have this radius is capital R, and we are interested in finding the field intensity at this point, inside point. Means if I draw one sphere, at this point we are interested in finding the field intensity. Now if we go for the integration, it might be little difficult. Now you see, due to the spherical symmetricity, the field is along the radial direction. At any point it will be in the radial direction. So if that is the case, if you take a Gaussian surface which is spherical, spherical Gaussian surface, then at all the points on this surface, electric field will be radially outward. This I am taking of radius r only. Then let electric field here is E. Electric field at the surface of this Gaussian surface is E. Then the flux linked with this Gaussian surface is E into 4 pi r square. This must be equal to the charge enclosed by epsilon naught. Now, since this is non-uniform charge distribution, to determine the value of charge enclosed, here we have to go for integration. But that integration won't be that much lengthy as if we have to do it by for computation of the electric field, right? Means by integration technique. So here what we are going to do, we are taking one small sphere, spherical shell of radius x and dx width. Then the volume of this shaded portion will be 4 pi x square dx, and the charge enclosed by this shaded portion will be rho at this location. Rho at this location is rho naught into 1 minus x by r, and volume is 4 pi x square dx. So the charge enclosed by this Gaussian surface, charge enclosed by this encircled Gaussian surface will be, is given by dq integral 0 to small r, that is rho 4 pi rho naught x square 1 minus x by r into dx, integrate 0 to r. Whatever value of this q you got, substitute this charge here and you will get the value of E. This is the way to use the Gauss law to determine the field by using the Gauss law due to spherical charge distribution I have done. Okay, I hope you have understood. Now in the next video, we'll discuss about the behavior of conductors in electrostatics.